the Dolomites, home of the Ladin people. They live in the four valleys emanating from the Sela mountain group, the Gruden, Fassam, Buchenstein, and Gadatal valleys. Visitors experience a mountainscape wonderland and are made to feel very welcome among the down-home German and Italian-speaking locals. This part of the Alps is characterized by an ever-changing combination of gentle slopes and steep cliffs. Many of the impressive mountains are over 3,000 meters high and are a real treat for rock climbers. But also for hikers, the Dolomites offer countless paths and hiking trails that are a bit easier to master. During the late Middle Ages and up until the time of Napoleon, the border between Germany, Austria, and Italy ran through this rocky paradise with its rugged stone faces and cliffs, an area also known as the White or Pale Mountains. This impressive piece of real estate is home to one of the greatest extreme mountaineers of all time, Hans Kammerlander. Of the 14 8,000ers on Earth, he has conquered 13 of them. He has also climbed nearly all of the peaks in his home mountain range. This rock climbing superstar accompanied us on our mountain tour, not one we did in climbing shoes, but rather from above, in a helicopter. Hi, my name is Hans. We are here in the Three Peaks area of the Sexton Dolomites. It is a beautiful day and the south faces of the peaks are lit up behind us, the easiest faces to climb. The north faces are much steeper and have an indescribable climbing history. This is where it all began for me, before I went out to the Himalayas, to Karakorum. But every time I come back from those expeditions and can be here, it simply makes me happy. I have to say that for me, these are the most beautiful mountains in the world, without a doubt. But let's make it simple. Let's get aboard the helicopter. We'll just show you this awesome mountain landscape from the air. Our helicopter with its powerful engine has been prepared for the flight by our navigator, Heinz Kugler. Heinz has fitted the aircraft with the camera smoother that he himself helped construct. Gabriel Kostner, who lives in the Grudna Valley, is one of the world's best mountain helicopter pilots with Himalaya experience. He is our pilot. Hans Jochler is running the camera. He spent numerous hours in this special construction by Heinz and Max Bayer in order to get the footage for this film. First thing each flight, Gabriel circles around the Ratschutze crucifix and prays for a safe return home. Passing by the Langkofel, made famous by the South Tyrolean filmmaker Louis Trenker, the flight takes us deeper into these mountains of myths and Ladin sagas. Our navigator Heinz has mapped out our flight plan and guides us along the way. The Dolomites are part of the Northern Limestone Alps and are primarily made up of dolomite. This stone consists of coral reef material and, according to some scientists, was formed as the African continent collided with Eurasia about 135 million years ago. The tectonic force of that event pushed sediments up from the floor of the primeval ocean Thetis to form a massive range of mountains, the Alps of today. Over eons of time, ice ages and erosion formed today's peaks and valleys. The continual change between gentle meadows and the sudden protrusion of enormous towers of rock with their reflex structures is characteristic of the Sexton and neighboring Dolomites. Erosion does a mean job on the soft limestone. That is why most peaks are surrounded by piles of rock debris. One always needs to count on falling rocks and even massive boulders splitting off the rock face. That, however, does not hamper the mountaineering enjoyment of the thousands of hikers and climbers that visit the region each year. We are now in front of the north faces of the three Zinnen, or parapets. These pinnacles are wonderful to behold, as if sculpted by an artist. To the left is the little parapet, first climbed by well-known Paul Preuss. Then the middle one, the great classic. Its north face was first climbed by Emilio Comici, a great rock climber. To the right is the westernmost and probably the steepest of the north faces. It was conquered by Riccardo Cassin. Those rock faces hold so many memories. I've been here very often as well during every season of the year. I have been on those faces at night, also during thunderstorms, which were very, very frightening. So when I look at these peaks, many memories, many experiences come back to me. I know the north faces of the parapets really well. In the meantime, there are countless routes. In the past, the level of difficulty was at the upper end of the sixth level. The scale didn't go any higher. In the meantime, everything has exploded. Rock climbing has developed incredibly. And even here on the north faces, there are routes rated beyond the 10th skill level, the absolute maximum that one can climb. And that includes overcoming an overhanging rock face. That is really for only the strongest rock climbers in the world. The parapets are also very dangerous in bad weather. They stand there like huge lightning rods, and when a thunderstorm hits, one feels the electrical charges very quickly if caught out there. Those are the extremely dangerous moments. You are so helpless. A difficult passage can be climbed. One can try to secure oneself well. But if a thunderstorm hits suddenly, you become a tiny speck on this huge rock face, especially as you get close to the summit. That is such a dangerous place in bad weather. The three Zinnen are a sort of icon of the Dolomites. In 1869, Paul Grohmann from Vienna, Franz Innerkofler, and Peter Salcher dared to be the first to climb the largest parapet. 10 years later, Michael Innerkofler, a relative of the Innerkofler brothers, together with George Plona, were the first to tackle the western pinnacle. The particularly difficult little parapet was conquered for the first time in 1881. Michael and Hans Innerkofler dared the attempt, and won. To this very day, attaining the master title for climbing all three Zinnen is one of the most important experiences in a rock climber's career. Yes, I have been on the summits of the little and the large parapets, but all using the easiest ascent. But you also need to consider the equipment back then. Today, the equipment is all so perfect. No, the route that I took could be done today by anyone who is halfway in shape. But listen, you guys are in my way. I need to take a picture. But you don't have to be a brave rock climber to enjoy the impressive mountain view from the foot of the three parapets. Here, from the Patten saddle, one has an awesome mountain view. We can see the Patten-Koffel formation, the Schuster plateau. Behind that, the three parapet alpine lodge, the Toblinger node, and the Haunold mountain. The panorama continues on to the Dürnstein, a fantastic hiking mountain, an amazing panorama summit, and then the Hohe Geisel in the background, one of the highest points of the Dolomites, a very high alpine summit. The Hohe Geisel, the highest mountain in the Pragsen Dolomites, lies on the border between South Tyrol and the Italian province of Venice. Among rock climbers, it is known as the highest mountain in the Dolomites, with the most difficult normal ascent. This craggy landscape offers almost nothing under skill level 3 to 4. Many exposed places require strong nerves and a lot of alpine experience. During the winter, the Hohe Geisel is a very special treat, not only for winter sport, but also to draw back and prepare for upcoming tasks, small or large. For the extreme climber, the hike to the Three Peaks or Drei Zinnen Lodge seems more like a walk in the park as they take on this little needle overlooking the lodge as a snack. Ironically, it is called the Frankfurter sausage. For the normal mortal mountain enthusiast, the 360-degree panorama of nature's own climbing garden is sufficient to produce similar feelings of enjoyment to those the extreme climbers might experience on a steep rock face. In the background, naturally very striking, the yellow edge of the little parapet, a great challenge for extreme rock climbers. I myself experienced the greatest stroke of luck of my life on that very edge. Years ago, I was climbing alone, and at a very, very steep place, one of my shoe soles broke. It was a prototype, a stiffened sole. All of a sudden, the sole broke. The shoe slid out, and I was pendling, hanging by only one hand. That was very, very close. And if I had fallen, no one would have known that the shoe sole broke on me. But that was a very, very, very critical moment. I think about it often. But otherwise, I have enjoyed nothing but fantastic hours on these rock faces. And not just I, but countless other climbers as well. You can watch them hanging way up there. And when they come down, they are beaming and laughing. They are simply happy. One of the favorite rock faces close to the Three Parapet Lodge is the Toblinger Node. A partially secured, relatively easy ascent leads up the northeastern flank to the summit. On the western edge and the southwestern face, the level 3 ascent provides much more of a challenge. The Toblinger Node, as well as the Potternkofel Formation, were both high-altitude alpine battlefields during the First World War. The Austro-Hungarian Empire fought bloody battles with Italy over a few meters of alpine ground, something that makes no sense at all from today's perspective. The 2,744-meter-high mountain is located on the border between South Tyrol and the Italian province of Belluno. Franz Innerkofler was the first person to reach the summit, which he did in 1882. The 4th of July, 1915, marked a black day in the mountaineering scene of that time. Sepp Innerkofler, who had been the proprietor of the Three Parapet Lodge for many years, as well as a heroic rock climber, died a soldier's death nearly at the summit as he attempted to liberate the mountain from the Italian Alpini mountain troops. Supposedly, it was not even an enemy bullet that caused his fatal fall, but rather a stone thrown by an enemy soldier that struck him in the head. Just shortly before, the thrower had saved Innerkofler's life on the large parapet. Back then, there was a code of honor that differentiated between a fellow mountaineer in distress and an enemy of war. The sad incidents of the First World War have passed these ancient mountains by like a whisper in the wind. The first Dolomite offensive in the Mountain War was fought in July of 1915. The front ran between the Col di Lana and the Tofana Massif west of Cortina d'Ampezzo. In his film, Mountain in Flames, Louis Trenker described the events which took place on the Schreckenstein, known today as Castelletto. He himself served as a soldier in this region. The scars of powerful explosions of that time and the remaining bunker ruins can be seen to this day. 24 tons of explosives changed the look of this rock face forever. The grandiose mountain scenery is indelibly marred by its wound. The sad thoughts fade quickly, however, as we fly over the Fanes. The karst bowl in the middle of the Fanes Seine Prague National Park is over 2,000 meters above sea level. The plateau is a protected natural reserve, completely surrounded by the Fanes mountain chain. The Lever Lake nestles between meadows and small Arola pine woods. Although the ascent leans over dry rock with no streams or bubbling brooks, the high-altitude plateau bathes in abundant water. Thick greenery grows here in the summer. It is the place where, according to the complex Fanes saga of the Ladins, the eagle people and their king fought against the people of women and groundhogs. In the springtime, these alpine fields are literally overgrown with wildflowers and herbs. This makes the plateau very well suited for pasturing livestock. In these protected pastures, the domesticated animals enjoy nearly unbridled freedom, at least during the short alpine summer season. The Fanes is an ideal habitat for other animals as well. The grass-covered rock terraces are well protected from wind and weather by the surrounding mountains, and the countless small cracks and crevices in the rocks of this giant amphitheater provide ideal homes for the alpine groundhogs. There is certainly a bit of time left over for play and for finding a mate, but the rodent's most important task is to build up abundant fat reserves during the short summer months. Out of the 12 months of the year, they spend up to 9 of them in hibernation. This kind of romantic setting naturally attracts many hikers, and rock climbers also find challenging ascents up the surrounding mountains. Not far from the Fanes, below the Pragian Lake Mountains, is the Proxer Wild Lake. Its geological origin goes back to the formation of a natural dam created by a mudflow. The lake plays an important role in South Tyrolean sagas. According to legend, one could reach the underground parts of the Fanes kingdom by boat from this lake. The entrance to the underworld, which has since been sealed by a landslide, was supposedly located at the southern end of the lake, under the mighty Seekofel cliffs. With a depth of only 36 meters, the lake is relatively shallow for a mountain lake. From the Proxer Wild Lake, we fly over the town of Cortina d'Ampezzo, and from there up to the 2,236-meter high pass Passo di Giau. It is one of the highest vantage points in the Alps and is located below the Monte Nuvolao mountain. There are many so-called towers in the Dolomites which are very impressive at first glance. In the end, however, they are not so interesting for rock climbers. You can do some climbing on the front face, but only short ascents. From the back, however, the summits can be reached easily, or relatively easily, over grassy slopes. That is very rewarding for hikers, but a bit less interesting for serious rock climbers, because there are simply so many other dream cliffs to climb in the area. In the background, naturally very distinctive, the 800-meter-high Tofana South Face. That is a great challenge for any extreme climber. In some places, the rock is brittle and unsound. The many stones and gravel fields at the base of the tower testify to that fact. Of course, it is also impressive that the back of the tower can be climbed by a sure-footed hiker with a good head for heights. So you don't have to be an extremer to reach the summit and enjoy the amazing view from the over 3,000-meter-high Tofana. But unfortunately, the ravages of the Alpine War left their mark here as well. During the night of the 17th to the 18th of April 1916, the Col di Lana lost its peak to a massive explosion. Here in front of us, we have the Queen of the Dolomites, the Marmolata. It is the highest peak in the Dolomites, the only glacier. If we look a bit more to the right, way in the background, the Rosengarten makes its appearance, and then the Selastock, Pisboe, and further to the right in the background, you can already see the Geisler group. Again, another beautiful panorama of some of the very significant mountain areas of the Dolomites. At 3,152 meters, the Pisboe is the only 3,000er in the Selastock group. But it is the easiest in the Dolomites. For enthusiasts among rock climbers, the summit can be reached via one of the most difficult ascents in the Dolomites, the Piazzetta. Anyone looking for a more comfortable ride books a flight with Gabriel Kosna or one of his colleagues, like we did. The view from a helicopter puts the mountain landscape in a whole new perspective, when the highest points are not the peaks themselves, but the aircraft hovering above them. Another advantage is that a side trip to another alpine massif goes very quickly, and Gabriel gives us a good reason why. A flight over the Dolomites without the ascent over the Laurine face into the massive formation of the world-renowned Rosengarten group is just not complete. Linguistic experts think that the romantic name of this bizarre rocky world has its origin in the ancient Ladin root Ruz, which means as much as a pile of gravel. That might be a pretty realistic description, but it just doesn't really do justice to the beauty of these rock formations, does it? The distinctive six violet needles in the center of the Rosengarten are set on two separate pedestals. They are separated by the so-called Winkel Gap. The needles were climbed for the first time between 1882 and 95. Nearly all of them by single mountaineers. The violets are also popular today because the ascent routes begin just moments away from the Gotel Lodge. On a clear day, after reaching the summit of the Rosengarten tip or one of the other peaks of the Rosengarten group, one can see all the way over to the Fannes chain, which we have already gotten to know. And here, Hans presents us with a mountain for so-called tennis shoe tourists. In front of us is the Lager Zwei. We can also see the cable car station, so the summit is easy to reach. The cable car takes you up and down, summer or winter. That means, of course, that masses of people are taken up there. And as they fan out all over the mountain, it can even get pretty dangerous at times. Particularly because of the cable car, the Lager Zwei is a mountain of many possibilities to travel to the summit and be amazed at the incredible Dolomite panorama. The hiker can walk up, the mountaineer can climb up, and if one is a bit more adventurous, there is a mountain tunnel left over from the war, and you can hike underground through the mountain with a miner's lamp all the way up to the cable car station. Not to mention the winter traffic of skiers riding up to the station. There are a number of challenging ski slopes leading into the valley below. In the background, the Falzarego towers. They are actually smaller towers, easy to reach, short ascents, and particularly for us mountain guides, very popular tours. They are very steep and offer good handholds, as is generally the case with most Dolomite cliffs. But time spent on the craggy Dolomite cliffs leaves lasting impressions on a person, not to mention the incredible depths one can experience there. Anyone looking for the spectacular climbs one of the Cinque Torre, or Five Towers. Actually, there are no longer five towers, but only four. The fifth fell prey to erosion and collapsed in 2004. The Cinque Torre are also easily accessible to hikers. Rock climbers measure themselves against the many ascents, rated at skill levels 3 and upwards, up the steep cliffs. As dramatic as the Dolomite rock faces appear at first glance, they are not all difficult to climb. That becomes more clear upon closer inspection. This is a typical Dolomite rock wall. This type of stone is very good to climb because of its rough and eroded surface. Often, approaching a cliff like this, one might think it to be unclimbable at first glance. But as you get closer, you see that its surface is very rough and stable in most cases, and grips are everywhere. For the rock climber, I just have to say, an ideal climbing region unlike anywhere else in the world. Everyone can find what they're looking for. Steep or gentle, it's just nice. But you do need to have a good head for heights if you decide to travel straight up vertically. That being said, however, you can also test your limits in the Dolomites nearly risk-free. On the golf course, for example, against this dream backdrop. You can conquer the 2,574-meter high Monte Nuvolau, not far from the Cinque Torre, with almost no adrenaline rush. At the summit, the Alpine Lodge, built in 1883 at the edge of the steep fall-off, is the perfect place to rest and enjoy a snack. If you want to enjoy the view of the Averau peak a bit longer and stay overnight, you will need to be happy with simple lodging conditions. Before climbing to the next rocky giant, we fly over well-known Dolomite towns like Sant Cassian, Colfusc, Corvara, or La Villa. Most of the inhabitants live off of tourism, agriculture, and handcrafts. Most Ladins are well off financially, but for that they must be willing to endure a massive flood of tourists during the summer months and during the winter skiing season. On the other hand, the South Tyroleans are so secure in their own culture that they are able to convert nearly every hectic city dweller to their more relaxed pace within a very short time. Living under the shadow of these stone giants, it is not the tempo that counts, but the wise investment of one's available strength. The region has experienced enormous development. If walking is too difficult, one takes the cable car up the mountain and enjoys floating through the exquisite dreamscape with a view of the Sasonga. Those, on the other hand, who enjoy more physical exercise, ask one of the many certified mountain guides to provide them with the adventure of their lifetimes. That is guaranteed on the Pishadu ascent. The ascent takes one onto the Exna Tower and then over a hanging bridge to the Bruneka Tower. Heart palpitations up here are not necessarily a sign of overexertion. During the summer, one may be forced to take a break because of slower climbers ahead of you. For those not used to spending time at these heights, a look down can easily result in trembling hands or thighs. But have no fear, the ascent is excellently secured and technically approved by the government safety agency. Having mastered that adventure, the Italian Alpine Club's Pishadu Lodge offers a welcome refuge of rest. It is romantically set on the edge of a small glacial lake. The glacier itself lies hidden under the gravel and rock debris. Seemingly only a stone's throw away, north of the Pishadu, the Chierspitzen tower above the Gardena Pass. The area surrounding the rocky towers must have been a good hunting ground for alpine rush, for example. Paleontologists suggest that the larger Chierspitze was climbed very early on by Ladin hunters, or perhaps the enthusiastic climbers were only after an unobstructed view of the Sela mountain group. In primitive times, without any sort of mountain climbing equipment, but people of those ancient times certainly did not dare to tackle the awesome steep cliffs of the 2,907-meter-high Heilig Kreuzkofel. It is part of the Faunus group, and borders the Garratal, also known as Alta Badia, to the east. Under the Great West Wall lies the pilgrimage church Heilig Kreuz, or Holy Cross. Today, the pilgrimage church, built in the mid-17th century, is a house of refuge and a restaurant. The Heilig Kreuz Koffel is also important to mountaineering history. The best alpine mountaineers of their time prepared and documented their routes of ascent up the extremely difficult rock faces. The first-time route up the middle tower, taken by the world-renowned South Tyroleans Reinhold and Günther Mesna, is of particular importance for the region. Rated at the time at skill level, also known as the level of difficulty, number 6, it has been upgraded in the meantime to skill level 7+. That is a rock face where you rarely meet another climber. You have to do all your own securing and be very careful not to miss the route. You need to have a lot of experience, otherwise something like this is not suitable. I have to say that I have never on any other alpine cliff face, and I have done countless climbing tours, fallen into my rope. But on this western wall of the Heilig Kreuz Koffel, one of my pinions broke loose, and I fell, suddenly and heavily, into the rope. My heart sure missed a few beats. I wouldn't need that to happen every day. When a rock face like the Heilig Kreuz Koffel throws even world-class rock climbers like Hans Kammerlander into the ropes, it is certainly worthy of being considered an important proving ground for the best of the best among mountaineers. But what is this material exactly that these mountain enthusiasts are dealing with? Scientifically speaking, it is a carbonate or limestone consisting of nearly 90% dolomite. The mineral dolomite itself is either white or often ivory-colored, light gray, gray-yellow, or green-gray. It was discovered by the French geologist Déodat de Dolomeo. We have him to thank for today's name of these mountain ranges, formerly known as the White or Pale Mountains. But the mineral dolomite is not only found in the Dolomite Mountains themselves. The stone is found all over the world. Whether rock climbing is a reasonable occupation is left to the eye of the beholder. But certainly, after an extreme rock climber battles his way up a challenging cliff, summer or winter, only to look down on the gentle slopes he could have easily strolled up in tennis shoes, he certainly must snicker to himself in amusement. Only a few kilometers northeast of the Heilig Kreuz Koffel, the Neune Spitze doesn't need winter to be clothed in white, although it is a popular place for winter skiing. Here as well, climbers follow in the footsteps of the Mesna brothers. They were the first to conquer the majestic cliff. No part of the ascent is rated under skill level 4 or 5, and the exhausting tour requires very good physical condition. A mountain pilot needs to be in good shape as well, but not to quite the same extent. Fine-tuned motor skills, good coordination, and a good natural three-dimensional spatial sensitivity are more important in his case. Gabriel Kosna is a master in all those areas and loves to dance over the craggy peaks. Here in the background, we see one of the greats, the Langkofel with its 1,000-meter high north face. The Langkofel was made known primarily by Louis Trenker. It was also his home mountain. Our day is also coming to a close with this wonderful evening atmosphere, and I would like to express my heartfelt thanks and say goodbye to all mountain fans everywhere. We finish off with a flight over the favorite mountain of the great artist and mountaineer, Louis Trenker. In 1869, Paul Grohmann was the first to conquer this 3,181-meter high giant. Later, it became the characteristic open-air mountain setting for many rock climbing movies. In contrast to the rock climbers, the flyover posed no physical danger to the camera team. From a distance, the Langkofel rises into the air, a famous landmark, inviting and even challenging people from around the world to visit the Pale Mountains at least once in their lifetime. We were here, and we will certainly be back more than once.